Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Thousand Li, The First Stop, a cultivation novel by Tao Wong, narrated by Travis Baldree. Chapter 1. The peace of the lush green slopes was broken by the chorus of bells, rousing Wu Ying from his cultivation. The bells were a reminder for the cultivators of the Verdant Green Waters sect of the time of day. Each bell was beautiful, harmoniously tinkling along to the sounds of the never-ending rush of water from the glacier-fed waterfalls. Wu Ying stood, dusting off his robes as he walked out of the courtyard of his building. While there was a quarter hour left before the start of classes, Wu Ying resided in the smallest, meanest, and most remote house for inner sect members. It would take him the quarter hour to arrive at the classroom, if he did not wish to arrive looking as though he had been run over.
"Breakfast, Lord,"
Ai Yi said, holding up a tray. "No, thank you. Not today. And please stop calling me Lord," Wu Ying said, his stomach a little knot of tension. Even if he was an inner sect member now, he was still a peasant, and being called a Lord did not feel right to him.
"Of course, Lord Long."
Ai Yi bowed again before moving out of Wu Ying's way. The cultivator sighed and left his house, striding off up the mountain. As much as he tried to correct his servant, the woman was as stubborn as he was. Even outlining the ways he was not a lord, Wu Ying was no nobleman, no court cultivator, no magistrate, had done nothing. But if Ai Yi thought he would give up, she would be surprised. Wu Ying was a farmer, and the one thing all farmers had was stubbornness. You had to be if you did not want to starve. Wu Ying looked around the quiet, dusty trail that led to his house and smiled. The building which housed him was more luxury than Wu Ying had ever experienced in his life. How quickly he was adapting to the new level of luxury did surprise him, and Wu Ying felt somewhat guilty as he reflected upon his dingy, three-bay family home. Still, the money he was now sending back would improve the lives of his parents. If he could, Wu Ying hoped to find some medicine to aid in the healing of his father's leg, giving him back full mobility. But it was a faint hope for now. Any medicine that could fix decades-old injuries on a body cleanser would be ruinously expensive, even for an inner sect member like him. As Wu Ying hurried along the pathway, the cultivator turned his thoughts away from his family to more immediate concerns, among them the most pressing, arriving on time. The Verdant Green Waters sect covered the full expanse of an enormous mountain, and the numerous buildings, including the lecture halls, spread across a wide area. The outer sect members lived on the lower levels of the mountain with their lodging, dining halls, and services located below. But for inner sect members, their requirements lay higher on the mountain where the important buildings were located. Each building Wu Ying passed was constructed of expensive hardwood and adorned with detailed carvings along their multi-inclined partitioned roofs. This gave the buildings a graceful, sweeping stature and ensured that the buildings stayed cool during the humid summer months. Everywhere Wu Ying looked, he spotted members of the outer sect toiling, caring for the beautiful architecture and grounds. The outer sect members undertook the menial jobs, from sweeping the roads to patching worn paint jobs to carrying supplies, that kept the sect functioning and beautiful. Soon enough, the cultivator came to a fork in the road and took the right fork. The left led farther up, but for today, the mid-levels of the inner sect portion were where he needed to be. At the turnoff, Wu Ying met a familiar face.
"Tao Hu,"
Wu Ying greeted his bald, ex-monk friend. The smiling man, clad in his orange monk robes, bowed to Wu Ying. That the youngster still managed to wear his old affiliate robes in the middle of the sect spoke of both the influence of his sponsoring elder and the general respect proffered under the religious organization.
"Wu Ying, you're here too,"
Tao Hu said with a smile.
"Isn't that my line?"
"You have been gone for weeks now," Wu Ying said.
"What happened?"
"Nothing major," Tao Hu replied, scratching the top of his shorn head. "My sponsor felt I needed more training."
"More training?"
Wu Ying's eyebrows rose in surprise. Tao Hu was one of the most natural martial prodigies Wu Ying had ever seen, if not the most. Without even trying, Tao Hu managed to achieve levels of understanding of martial styles others clawed and struggled their way toward.
Taohua had managed to enter the inner sect in his first year, all the while doing the least amount of work possible.
Yes, we had to face a number of demon beasts on the expedition, Taohua explained as the pair headed toward the lecture halls. A culling on the Huangzhou forest. The local lord paid for our involvement and the elder was interested in a particular demon stone. We had to trek inward for nearly a week before we found traces of the beast.
Sounds exciting, Wu Ying said.
Not really. Oh, there were fights, but it was mostly a lot of walking and camping. The only good thing was the amount of demon meat we were able to eat.
A smile lit up the ex-monk's face.
Have you ever tried third stage demon boar?
At Wu Ying's shake of his head, Taohua continued.
It's so much better than second stage. The taste is richer and deeper, and the fat.
Wu Ying chuckled as Taohua regaled him about the meat they'd eaten. At the lecture hall, Wu Ying led Taohua around the corner, heading for a side entrance which led them to the top of the hall itself. The rafters were mostly empty, just a few other individuals were present. The vast majority of the inner sect members who were attending the lecture were downstairs, where they were more likely to hear and be heard better.
What's this lecture about?
Taohua asked softly. Wu Ying chuckled, as he was not the one who was out of the loop. Liu Song had spent the first few days of his initiation, after Wu Ying had recovered, ensuring he completed all the bureaucratic necessities correctly this time. Along the way, Wu Ying had also managed to learn more about the way the inner sect worked.
It's one of the introductory lectures, Wu Ying said. How were you here if you didn't know about it? I was following everyone else. What's an introductory lecture?
You know how there are three kinds of lectures, Wu Ying said,
and Taohua shook his head.
Well, there are the private lectures, which are only accessible if the elder invites you. Those are generally meant for those who are already a disciple of the elder. Then there are the paid lectures. Those elders lecture on the topics of their expertise, but those lectures are open to more students and are less personal. Lastly, there are the public introductory lectures. The elders rotate constantly as the lectures are repeats, but they're a good introduction to the various occupations, fighting styles, and introductory knowledge a serious cultivator requires.
And this is an introductory lecture,
Taohua said as the pair took seats. The lecture hall was a small half-oval with two levels facing the simple stage.
To what?
Cultivation in the energy storage phase, Wu Ying said.
Since the sect was not a school and the intake of new members to the inner sect was sparse, the introductory lectures were never set up to cater to the new members. Instead, new inner sect members were expected to work with their sponsoring elders or other senior members to brush up on what they needed to know. Of course, introductory lectures to the basics of each occupation happened too, but those were often scattered throughout the year as demand built up.
Who's lecturing?
Before Wu Ying could showcase his ignorance, their lecturer walked on stage. Wu Ying's eyes widened, then narrowed as he mentally chided himself. Of course, Fairy Young was the most likely candidate. Not only was this lecture extremely basic, the fairy was also the newest elder in the sect. Such menial duties would obviously fall to her. Yang Fa Yuan was the youngest, most famous elder in the sect. Most of her infamy came from her beauty. Her pale, fair skin was set off by long lashes and lustrous black hair, a delicate jaw, and a shapely, long-limbed figure. Her title of fairy was indubitable and unarguable, and many a cultivator had spent hours daydreaming about the cold, imperious beauty.
Today's lecture is about the beginnings of energy storage and its differences from cultivation in the body cleansing stage. For those who have advanced to the later stages, this lecture is of little benefit.
Fa Yuan paused, obviously waiting for a few cultivators who stood up and left. Her gaze grew colder as it swept over the members of nobility who stayed before moving to the rafters and spotting Wu Ying in group. As his senior and another student sponsored by Elder Cheng, the pair had a more intimate connection than most.
Energy storage, unlike the body cleansing stage of cultivation, is significantly more dangerous. This is because the energy storage meridians in a cultivator's body are entirely closed off, unlike the 12 meridians which are opened during the body cleansing stage. As such, to open each new meridian, a cultivator must use additional qi to breach and cleanse these meridians.
Fa Yuan said.
Use too little, and a cultivator faces backlash from the backflow of qi into their dantian and meridians. Use too much, and you can damage your energy meridian.
The soft scrape of ink on paper resounded through the hall as cultivators took notes. Wu Ying sat forward, hands clasped as he listened intently. Thus far, the fairy had not said anything he had not known, though his lack of notes was also due to his lack of funds. Tao He was quietly turning prayer beads in his hand as he listened.
Now, the amount of energy used varies greatly depending on the type and aspect of one's qi. This is why the presence of an elder is always recommended during the first attempt at breaking into the energy storage stage,
Fa Yuan said.
However, time has shown certain truths. Using the Yellow Emperor's cultivation method, it can be deduced that for the majority, double the amount of qi used to break the 12th meridian is required to open the first energy storage meridian. As to which meridian to open first, it is, of course, a matter of your cultivation style. However, many styles have multiple routes of opening. This is unlike core creation stages, where the development of your core is specified in exacting steps. In light of this, the energy storage channels and their uses are as follows.
Wu Ying made sure to listen and memorize as best he could. Much of this knowledge was theoretical, but knowledge could always bring a moment of enlightenment. Still, a part of Wu Ying noted his need to speed up his own cultivation. As a body cleanser 8, he was the weakest cultivator in the inner sect by at least one level. While it was unlikely he would be driven from the inner sect, a lack of progress in the next year would definitely carry penalties. An hour later, the lecture was complete. As Wu Ying got ready to leave, he straightened in surprise as a voice entered his ear.
Come down, we should speak,
Fa Yuan said, sending her voice to his ear via spiritual communication. It was the first time Wu Ying had experienced this form of communication, but he found himself nodding automatically. I have to meet Elder Yang, Wu Ying informed Tao He.
No problem. I need to visit the inner administration hall,
Tao He said.
See you there?
Possibly. It depends on what Elder Yang desires, Wu Ying said. Tao He nodded, of course, and the pair split up, Wu Ying making his way down the stairs to the edge of the stage. As he walked up to the fairy, he felt the jealous stares of the nobles who had hung behind, not daring to approach the elder directly.
Elder Yang,
Wu Ying said, bowing in greeting.
Junior Long.
Fa Yuan's words caused a stir among the inner sect members, many who did not know of their relationship. Gazes grew even more heated as Fa Yuan continued.
Elder Cheng has left for the time being. He has mentioned you might require some help during this period.
Wu Ying bowed again, smiling. Elder Cheng was considered somewhat eccentric, his belief in fate sometimes trumping what many would consider common sense. That he even mentioned this matter to Fa Yuan was unusual and probably indicated Elder Cheng still thought he owed Wu Ying some minor karma.
Thank you, Elder Yang. I would be grateful for any assistance you might offer.
Very well,
Fa Yuan said approvingly.
Come, I have much to do. Now, tell me, have you chosen your supporting occupation?
No, Elder, Wu Ying said. I'm still learning of them.
Fa Yuan hummed in thought as the pair walked out of the lecture hall and turned toward the peak of the mountain.
Choosing a good supporting occupation is important. While certain prodigies or well-resourced individuals might be able to progress in 2 or 3 supporting occupations, for most, mastering a single occupation is their limit. A wise choice now can avoid heartaches in the future.
Yes, Elder.
Of the numerous supporting occupations available in the kingdom, the Verdant Green Waters sect has expertise only in a few. Blacksmithing, pill refining, and martial specialists have significant numbers of experts in the sect,
Fa Yuan said.
In addition, Elder Wang is a famous celestial formation master of the fourth ring. He is the one who upkeeps the defensive formations around the sect.
Wu Ying let his gaze roam over the surroundings. Of course, not being trained in celestial formations, he could not pick out the numerous changes to the landscape. Many long-term defensive formations were achieved by altering the natural landscapes of a location rather than the use of temporary formation flags. As the formations were part of the natural landscape, it was impossible for anyone untrained to spot their locations until they were activated.
We no longer have a vibrant spirit beast taming section, mostly due to the loss of Elder Cho. His death, along with his primary students, in the war a decade ago, has impacted the department significantly,
Fa Yuan said, a slight frown creasing her face.
Thus far, we have yet to find a suitable replacement for the elder. Do any of the ones mentioned interest you?
I don't know, Wu Ying said truthfully. I have heard pill refining is both lucrative and useful in cultivation.
It is,
Fa Yuan said,
but it is also an extremely costly occupation. To gain expertise in pill refinement, you must be willing to fail numerous times at production. Countless herbs and cores are wasted by new pill refiners. Can you afford such a loss?
Wu Ying's face fell at her words. Fa Yuan was correct. He did not have the background to become a pill refiner, as he lacked both knowledge and funds.
Think carefully not only about what might be easily accessible when choosing your secondary occupation, but also about your final Dao. Your supporting occupation must contribute to your Dao, not subtract from it. Too many fail at the final stage because of missteps along the way,
Fa Yuan said, stopping as they came to a crossroads. Down one street, the inner sect library resided. The other street led toward where the elders resided.
Research before we speak again on this matter.
Thank you, Elder, Wu Ying said, bowing. She nodded and turned, kicking lightly on the ground and moving up the hill at blinding speed with little effort. Left alone, Wu Ying turned his head from side to side, considering joining his friend or taking action on Fa Yuan's advice. In the end, Wu Ying sighed and strode toward the library. Tao He would understand. Wu Ying had no time to waste if he was to develop himself. Chapter 2. The inner sect library was built similarly to the outer sect library, except it was nearly half as large, with three floors of scrolls and books ranging from basic historic texts to treatises about specific cultivation styles. Unlike the outer sect library, numerous scholars were working inside and happy to speak with and aid Wu Ying's search. Interestingly enough, Elder Ku, who Wu Ying had assumed was the library head for the outer sect library, was actually the elder in charge of all libraries, as he had learned over the previous months. He transited between each library as needed, arranging for replacement attendants and scholars and taking consultation requests when he was present. Of course, other elders also worked in the library, but Elder Ku was a fixture and perhaps the most well-liked. Numerous cultivators owed their ongoing success to his guidance.
"Looking to learn about supporting occupations?"
the attendant said, stroking his long beard as Wu Ying approached him. The middle-aged scholar smiled.
"How about being a scholar? We always need young blood."
"Thank you, senior, but I don't know enough to know if such a path is suitable," Wu Ying said.
"Ah, but you know enough to come to the library,"
the bearded attendant said with a smile.
"That is the heart of a good scholar, the search for knowledge. It is here in our libraries where you will find the sum of human knowledge."
"Yes, senior. Still, I would like to do some study first," Wu Ying said.
"Ah, very well. Let me see. Gu's treatise on the five occupations should be a good start,"
the attendant said. Together, the pair wandered into the vaulted library, browsing the volumes on the bottom floor, which consisted of mundane manuals. Unfortunately, finding a document or book which listed the full variety of supporting occupations available to an individual was impossible. At best, some treatises discussed the differences and benefits of each occupation in comparison to another, but for the vast majority, the best Wu Ying and the helpful attendant could do was pull introductory manuals. Numerous books were available for the main occupations in the sect, but soon enough, Wu Ying found himself burdened with other documents detailing minor occupations the sect had once hosted or which an elder currently practiced and hoped to expand upon. There were many such minor occupations, like scholars, dancers, musicians, gatherers, and more. The skills provided by each of these supporting occupations could make a cultivator more powerful and also guide their central Dao.
"Are you sure I can take these?"
Wu Ying said, eyes wide.
"Of course. These are not cultivation manuals,"
the scholar said.
"We have multiple copies of all these documents. Though, if you fail to return these copies, you will be required to copy a new document, to our standards."
Wu Ying nodded quickly, acknowledging the threat. Considering these were all trained scholars, the required level of reproduction would be painful, It was a good threat, too. While the vast majority of the books he was reading looked to be print block productions, copying one by hand would be arduous and a waste of time. Of course, certain publications, like actual cultivation manuals, were mainly handwritten. Outside of the basic Yellow Emperor's Body Cleansing Cultivation Manual, which was distributed to all villagers, cultivation manuals were secret. Producing a printing press copy of these works would be anathema to the very idea of secrecy. Seated at his table, Wu Ying read through the works before him. He first focused on the main occupations available in the sect, finding the documentation profound and in-depth. Each manual obviously had its own bias, pushing the reader toward blacksmithing or pill refining or even combat specialization, and, in so doing, highlighted the flaws of focusing on each of those styles. Pill refining was, as noted by Elder Yang, highly expensive. There were two major areas of expertise a pill refiner needed to acquire. Firstly, the knowledge and understanding of the various herbs and alchemical components that went into a pill. Secondly, the actual process of refining a pill and the techniques in doing so. Failure in either portion spelled failure in the pill concoction. It was the reason even the lowest grade spiritual pill was so expensive. One was not just paying for the material of the pill itself, but all the failed pill concoctions in the past and all the failed pill concoctions in the refiner's future. For most individuals, the first step in pill refinement was studying herbs. In the sect, beginning pill refiners were assigned to work in the pill dispensary as gophers, picking out requested herbs from the storage rooms. In this way, beginning pill refiners could gain access to and view the herbs while having a more senior cultivator watch over their picks. "So, not impossible," Wu Ying said softly to himself. While he might not have the funds to purchase the herbs, he could spend his time building up the knowledge of the herbs, a potential avenue for development. The biggest advantage pill refiners had over most other major occupations was their versatility. Both talented blacksmiths and pill refiners could expect to make significant amount of taels with their skills, but pill refiners could create concoctions which helped one's cultivation journey, which cleansed poisons or healed bodies. Pills could strengthen an individual's fighting prowess or expand an attribute, providing greater benefits. At the later stages, common concoctions helped cultivators expand their senses, becoming one with the Tao and aiding them in gaining enlightenment. Blacksmiths, on the other hand, were more limited. In general, there were two kinds of specialized blacksmiths among cultivators, armorers and weaponsmiths. Of course, in the initial period, a beginner blacksmith would learn both forms and practice his overall craft. Blacksmiths were in constant demand, as the weapons they made added to a cultivator's strength. In addition, blacksmithing was significantly cheaper to begin. Failed products could be reforged a number of times.
"Though I'm not sure I'd like to buy a reforged sword," Wu Ying said.
He recalled the cheap weapons he had seen, pitted weapons or those with a slight bend to them. Trash weapons were often sold to peasant farmers who either did not know better or, in some cases, had no choice but to buy them. The idea of making something like that pained Wu Ying, though he shook away his doubts for now. Blacksmithing was an option, but because of its lower cost and requirements mentally, it also was more popular than pill refining. It also required a significant amount of physical strength and a fire attribute in their chi. If Wu Ying wanted to become a true blacksmith, then he would have to commit to becoming a fire chi user. As for the martial specialists, they were the most dangerous individuals. At later stages, martial specialists could specialize even further into team battle formations or army battle formations, becoming the leaders of numerous individuals. Such individuals could multiply the effectiveness of individual cultivators by numerous times. Individually, martial specialists often became a sect's protector, the individuals tasked with the overall safety of the sect. Until then, martial specialists had a difficult time progressing their cultivation, as they had no special skills to provide additional funds to develop their cultivation. This led to numerous deaths among martial specialists as they took on dangerous missions to gain the funds and cultivation resources they required. Between his initial study of the Long family sword style and his own experiences, Wu Ying knew he leaned toward being a martial specialist. While most cultivators had to know how to fight, martial specialists were the dedicated and gifted, and Wu Ying feared this was where he failed. Unlike his friend Tao He, Wu Ying was not particularly gifted. Oh, he was better than most at his level, there was no doubt, but in his heart of hearts, Wu Ying knew it was due to constant practice rather than any particular spark of genius.
"The library is closing,"
the voice interrupted Wu Ying's musings. The cultivator set aside the books he had read for storage and took the pile of other books with him, storing them away as he made his way back to his residence. Right now, none of the main secondary occupations drew Wu Ying. Perhaps somewhere in the pile of documents, Wu Ying might find something of more use. While progressing on a well-supported occupation was easier initially, as Elder Yang had mentioned, one's Dao was more important. Choose wrong now, and you could lose the opportunity to ascend. Over the next few days, Wu Ying spent his time enclosed in his residence, alternating between cultivation and study. Ah Yi was tasked with the work of alerting Wu Ying to any useful lectures as they appeared, allowing Wu Ying to focus entirely on study. Some occupations were easy enough to discard. He didn't have the time or desire to become a physician, for example, or a dancer. Music as a supporting occupation was intriguing, but it required a certain level of skill and talent to allow music to become a weapon. While Wu Ying could, and did, sing during the harvest and spring festivals, he had never been lauded for his ability. He had a farmer's voice, acceptable in groups, pitiful alone. As for instruments, theirs had never been a family of music. Other occupations had some intriguing possibilities. Scholarship required little from its students in the beginning. It was an arduous and long journey, though, with the amounts of knowledge one must accumulate ever increasing. But it did have the secondary advantage of allowing one to potentially sit for the kingdom examinations, a decent backup plan if there ever was one. Certainly, it was a way for Wu Ying to be near his family and stay in the kingdom if he failed to progress in his studies as a cultivator. Celestial formations was another intriguing area. The documentation provided was sparse, insufficient for Wu Ying to truly grasp. But it seemed to require both a talent in that area and a willingness to spend long hours studying the natural world. Still, the powers a formation power would provide were significant. What Wu Ying did learn was how there were two types of formations, those which were custom-built, like the sect's defensive formation, and those which were created from pre-made formation flags, transportable to numerous locations, but significantly less powerful. Beast taming was impossible, even if intriguing. Wu Ying liked animals, but without a proper guide, it was not an area he could explore. And liking animals was vastly different from dedicating oneself to the care and development of them through one's existence. Other occupations, like fortune-telling, tool-making, and puppet mastery, were not practiced in the sect anymore, even if their books were present. Then, of course, were the mundane or common supporting occupations that were made more exotic through the use of spiritual power and their handling of spiritual items. Spirit stone miners traversed deep mines, often in the most dangerous wilderness locations, to mine spirit veins and pull forth naturally occurring spirit-infused stone. Wu Ying was even more amused when he found reference to spirit farmers, farmers who worked with qi-infused rice, herbs, and other vegetables. Eating those ingredients, along with demon beast meat, hunted by both martial specialists and demon beast hunters, could boost a cultivator's absorption rate of qi. Wu Ying sighed and tossed the latest book with its allusions to demon beast hunters on the table in his office, crossing his arms in exasperation. Does every occupation feel the need to add spirit in front of its name to make it more prestigious?
Just about.
Wu Ying spun around to see Liu Song leaning against the wall. The smiling female cultivator was clad in the willowy robes of the inner sect, setting off her slim, almost boyish figure.
Senior!
Wu Ying jumped up and bowed to her. I did not know you were here.
Ah Yi must be out. I knocked but received no answer, so I came in,
Liu Song said.
But most occupations desire to be seen as more prestigious. And with 1,001 Daos in the universe, most occupations can locate some prestigious cultivator or immortal to back up their claims.
Wu Ying crossed his arms as anger washed over him.
How foolish was it to reach into the past and borrow the name of an immortal to raise one's work? If the work itself was not good enough in your own eyes, then only misery would accompany your existence, for no external validation would ever be enough. The rain clouds did not ask if the farmer approved. They came or not, as they desired.
Some occupations make a better case than others, of course. And some, like pill refining, demon beast taming, and blacksmithing, are inextricably linked to cultivation. Others are secondary.
Wu Ying glanced over the manuals. Does Senior have any recommendations?
So formal,
Liu Song mocked Wu Ying.
There's no harm in specializing as a martial specialist in the beginning while familiarizing yourself with the various occupations offered. Even if you never take it further, knowing the basics of blacksmithing and pill refining is beneficial.
I guess it could not hurt to check out the various occupations, Wu Ying said, realization seeping in that research did not need to occur only in the library. Thank you for your guidance.
Good, good,
Liu Song said with a smile.
Now remember, speak with the administrative hall first. If you wish to begin with pill refinement, you should try for an assignment at the pharmacy, but many vie for those. Without sufficient favor or an elder's backing, you can forget about receiving a role there.
Oh.
Do not look so down. You merely have to study properly. It might be slower, but spending time studying the basics will reinforce your learning,
Liu Song said.
Also, during the winter period, many vie for a place in the pharmacy. But it's the worst time to be there because the number of new refiners are at its peak.
Isn't that good? More work? Wu Ying said, confused.
More of the same kind of work. Everyone is trying to make the same bone-cleansing, meridian-opening, spirit-strengthening pills. After you pull the herbs for the 10th time, you'll be able to recognize them with your eyes closed. Then there are the frost-binding, chill-warding, ice-warding pills.
Bitter much? Wu Ying asked. Liu Song gave her friend a wry smile.
Yes, I got lucky, too. You're so busy you never get a chance to look at the other stored herbs. Spring and summer often sees many of the beginner refiners, the overconfident ones, give up. Then there are more seasonal pills, too, so your running is wider, too.
The weather makes a difference? Wu Ying said curiously.
Of course, drawing in the right qi is important for the proper development of certain pills. You could set up or use spirit formations to regulate the qi and environment, but those rooms are expensive to rent from the sect. Better to plan your production around the seasons,
Liu Song said. Wu Ying nodded, grateful for the wisdom the woman imparted.
Now, if you're serious about learning, you should purchase a copy of The Principles and Species of Roots and Herbs.
Is it available at the library? Wu Ying said. Liu Song shook her head.
Only a few copies, and those are not annotated. You need to pick up your own and begin annotating it. While it is comprehensive, there are mistakes in the work itself, as well as much that isn't covered.
Oh, do you have one? When Liu Song indicated she did, Wu Ying asked thoughtlessly, Can I borrow it then?
No!
Liu Song crossed her arms.
Would you show others your cultivation manual?
Wu Ying winced and bowed low, offering profuse apologies. A moment later, he felt a light smack over the top of his head.
Get up. I know you didn't mean anything from it, but it's still not something a refiner will ever show.
Yes, Senior.
Good. Now make sure to come to my class in a week.
Your class?
Well, really, my master's. But because it's for beginners, she has assigned me the task of showcasing the basics of herbology,
Liu Song said, preening a little. Congratulations, Senior. I'll be sure to come, with my own copy of the compendium.
Good, good. Now, what else have you been up to?
Well, soon enough, the pair fell into the usual gossip of sect life. But in the back of Wu Ying's mind was the desire to progress both his cultivation and secondary occupations. Chapter 3. The clang of hammers beating on iron rang through the building as the sweltering heat from the active forges made the cultivators sweat during this winter day. 2 days after Wu Ying's talk with Liu Song, he registered and squeezed himself into the most recent batch of blacksmithing students. There were, in fact, two different classes starting today. One group, consisting mostly of inner sect members, stood to the side and listened to the senior blacksmith as he explained their objectives for the day. All of those individuals had prior experience with blacksmithing and were now being given a series of projects to complete to gauge their level of expertise.
Wu Ying was in the other group, one consisting of a couple of his fellow newcomers to the inner sect and a few outer sect members. As Wu Ying looked around, he was amused to note that unlike the willowy, pale scholar appearance, which was the norm among the sect, many of the blacksmiths were muscular and stout. In fact, the blacksmith speaking to them was bare-chested, his sect robes tied off around his lower body as sweat gleamed off his pectorals and collected on wiry, dark chest hairs.
"You lot have indicated interest in blacksmithing. Just because you are interested does not mean we are in you," the blacksmith growled. "I, Gan Jiang, will see to your suitability. Each of you will be assigned a forge bellows to work. You will work the bellows for the day, following the directions of the assigned blacksmith. If you fail, if you stop, you will be removed from the class. Do you understand?"
The chorus of agreements made Jiang smile, his scruffy short beard, pocked with burnt spots, pulling against his lips. The blacksmith assigned the various students to forges. Wu Ying found himself deep in the building and far away from the open doors. As he walked farther in, Wu Ying felt sweat breaking out across his body under the intense heat.
"Hot," Wu Ying said. "You're not fire-aspected," the cultivator who walked up said.
The cultivator was broader than most scholars, but not overly muscled like the older blacksmiths. However, Wu Ying could sense the cultivator was strong, at least in the middle level of the energy storage stage.
"No," Wu Ying said, surprised the other had noticed.
Ever since he had begun practicing the aura strengthening technique, few others than elders could accurately grasp his cultivation.
"Then make sure to drink a lot of water," the cultivator said. "I do not need you feigning on me while I work."
"Yes, senior. This junior is Long Wu Ying," Wu Ying said, bowing.
"Wang Bao Tsung."
The blacksmith walked around the forge a bit before turning to Wu Ying.
"Go gather more coal, quickly."
By the time Wu Ying managed to return with the coal, after asking for directions to the charcoal storage, Bao Tsung had finished his inspection of his work area. In short order, Bao Tsung ordered Wu Ying to shovel in more coal and pump the bellows. As Wu Ying worked, Bao Tsung laid out the raw iron to be melted down and reshaped.
"Listen well. I need you to raise and keep the fire at a high temperature for most of it, and we'll be raising the temperature even higher later. Do not slack off, and keep working the bellows. I will inform you when to stop or when to increase your efforts," Bao Tsung warned Wu Ying.
Over the next few hours, Wu Ying worked under the direction of Bao Tsung. Soon, even Wu Ying's muscular arms ached as sweat dribbled down his face. Wu Ying soon learnt to keep the water skin close by, ready for use when he had a brief break. Out of the corners of his eyes, Wu Ying paid as close attention as he could to the entire process. Blacksmithing consisted of a few parts. He began by melting the raw iron and tossing away the slag, the unneeded portion of metal. Afterward, Bao Tsung placed the molten iron in molds, allowing the iron to cool into ingots, ready for working. Once the ingots had cooled enough, Bao Tsung would begin the actual process of blacksmithing by heating the metal in the forge before pounding the metal into shape. Over the next few hours, Bao Tsung would pull out the metal, hammer it flat, then reheat the metal when it cooled too far, striking the iron ingot into the shape he required. At first, Wu Ying found the entire process fascinating, but soon the cultivator grew bored. Lacking proper education or an explanation, Wu Ying did not understand why Bao Tsung pulled out the metal at certain times, beat on it, and returned the metal to the forge at others. While Wu Ying could tell Bao Tsung was striking the metal at specific angles, he could not understand what those angles were, the rhythm of motion, or why the other cultivator frowned and returned the metal to the forge. As no explanation was ever provided, Wu Ying found his attention waning. He kept one ear out for orders from Bao Tsung, content to keep working the forge bellows as instructed, acting almost on automatic. Mostly, though, he felt back into his mind, looking for and locating his dantian. The lower dantian was where Wu Ying's qi was mainly stored, flowing in circles and contained in the nebulous space beneath and behind his navel. There, the qi, that force of nature and creation, Wu Ying had gathered and made his own, flowed, entering his meridians and traversing the pathways of energy of his body. Most of this was done automatically, as simply and unconsciously as his heartbeat. Cultivation was the act of channeling that qi in an active manner, drawing qi into his body from the external world, making it part of his existence, and using it to cleanse clogged and dirty meridians. Properly done, the process was both a filtering and cleansing process, like filtering water and using that new clean water to wash drainage pipes that had been dirtied by repeated use. Since most external qi was aspected in one form or another, it was important for an individual to alter that qi and make it his own, transforming that qi in his body. At the body cleansing stage, a cultivator like Wu Ying had few uses for qi other than to cleanse and strengthen his body. Each cleansed meridian increased his strength as it allowed more qi to be used in even the most casual of motions. Of course, to cleanse a meridian, one must have sufficient qi to flood the cleansed meridian, or it would once again require cleansing. In either case, for the vast majority of cultivators, cultivation was done while being still. The concentration and care required to move qi through one's body was so great, they dared not do so while moving. A mistake while cultivating could injure or potentially cripple a cultivator, especially if said cultivator was soaking in qi from a moment of enlightenment. But due to previous training, Wu Ying was not one of those individuals. In fact, Wu Ying often found it beneficial to cultivate while moving. His preference was to be running, moving to new areas of fresh qi. As such, being in the forge and working the bellows was less than optimal. But to Wu Ying's surprise, the constant flames released a significant amount of fire qi into the air, along with threads of metal qi. Wu Ying worked to absorb and strain this qi through his dantian, concentrating and forcing the aspected qi out and keeping the unaspected amount within his body. This process of straining the qi was taxing on mind and body, forcing Wu Ying to drink water in ever greater amounts. Over the next few hours, the pair worked together. When Bao Zong finished his first piece and moved on to another project, Wu Ying stayed by the forge, working the bellows in companionable silence. The pair began to move in sync, Wu Ying unconsciously gaining a rough understanding of Bao Zong and his needs. It was, if Wu Ying took the time to analyze the matter, more an understanding of Bao Zong's body language and how he looked at and interacted with the steel than an understanding of the process itself. As the day drew to a close, Bao Zong finally quenched his last project. After setting the piece beside the other projects, he turned to Wu Ying and instructed the cultivator on how to bank the forge. Wu Ying slowed, then stopped his cultivation, stretching sore muscles and unkinking his back as he stood up fully. "Good. Now put the rest of the coal inside there and—" "What is that smell?" Bao Zong exclaimed as he neared Wu Ying. Bao Zong stepped back, holding his forearm to his nose as he desperately breathed through his mouth. As Bao Zong was no longer focused solely on his work, the pervasive stench of Wu Ying's cultivation sweat, flash-dried in the heat of the forge, began to tell. It was a mixture of rotten eggs, overturned manure, pus, and stagnant swamp water, all baked and concentrated. "Ah, that'd be me," Wu Ying's own nose wrinkled as he opened the rafter windows wider.
"Cultivating while working the forge, and not even as a fire qi user," Jiang said, his voice mild as he strode over. "An interesting use of your time in my forge."
"Elder?"
Wu Ying bowed to the other, his motion copied by Bao Zong.
"It took you too long enough to finish. All the others are done," Jiang said, gesturing around the forge.
At a glance, Wu Ying could not spot any of the cultivators he had entered the forge with in the morning. Not that the forge was empty. Other blacksmiths had taken over the forge spots, working on their own projects.
"Let us see what you have here," Jiang said.
Wu Ying started to approach before he received a pair of glares. Embarrassed, the cultivator hung back while still peering at the three projects Bao Zong had worked upon that day. The first was a simple, straight knife, one which lacked a hilt at this time. It had a full tang running down the slight arch which made up the guard of the knife. The second was an open-faced pot helm Wu Ying knew was made of two pieces hammered together with a third strip of iron solidified over the weld. The last piece was perhaps the prettiest of the three, the blade of a jian. Even from this angle, Wu Ying could tell the sword was a notch better quality than the pieces that he had worked with before he entered the sect. Jiang took his time in checking the pieces. He checked them for burrs and unfinished spots, for weight and distortions. For the sword, he even bent the blade with his bare hands before releasing the blade and checking its angle again. While Jiang went over the projects, Bao Zong watched the elder, his face a mask of impassiveness. But from behind him, Wu Ying saw how the cultivator clenched his fists, how they tightened whenever Jiang stopped or peered at something more closely. Jiang put the projects aside.
Barely adequate. The tempering work could be done better. Heat distribution was barely acceptable. The iron you used was not purified properly. And you are using the most simplistic of hammering techniques for all three. It would have been better to use the three-leaf technique for the dagger and the seven-wind and two-blossom technique for the sword. As for your helm, well, for a peasant it would be acceptable. No one else would wear such an ugly piece.
Yes, Elder, Bao Zong said, bowing his head as he was reprimanded.
Take your pieces and give them to the shop. They will price and sell them for you. Come back tomorrow. We will work on your technique, Jiang said, waving.
Bao Zong bowed, taking hold of the three pieces. Wu Ying tilted his head sideways at the elder's words before he remembered the works completed by the blacksmiths were their property. All blacksmiths paid the rental of the forge with sect contribution points and could elect to pay for materials with their points or with real money. Because of this, the materials and final products were considered theirs. Wu Ying's musings were cut short as Jiang turned toward him, staring at the cultivator.
You are unaspected, correct?
Yes, Elder.
Fire aspects are good for the actual act of forging, but do not be misled. It's not required. Metal aspects are extremely useful as well. The resonance with ores and metals provide a blacksmith a strong base.
Thank you for your advice, Elder.
Good. Now as for your work, Jiang said, scowling. Who told you to cultivate?
No one, Elder.
Fool, your job was not just to last the day, but to learn. Did you grasp the difference in the color of the coals? Did you see how much of a difference the temperature and airflow you provided mattered? How about when Bao Zong pulled out his work?
But I couldn't tell.
Of course not. Did you expect to learn how to do it immediately? Learning is a matter of repeated attempts. The more you pay attention, the faster you learn. If you are not interested in learning, I have no use for you.
My apologies, Elder.
Wu Ying bowed, wincing as he chided himself for taking the easy way out. He knew better, too. It was not as if what Jiang was saying was any different from what his father had taught him before.
You will come back in 3 days and join the class. You will work the bellows alone. If you fail to work the bellows the entire day by yourself while the class is learning, you fail. If you cultivate or lose focus, you fail. Do you understand?
Jiang said, leaning forward and glaring at Wu Ying.
Yes, Elder. Thank you, Elder.
Good.
Jiang stalked off. Once the elder left, the pair of waiting blacksmiths moved toward the now abandoned forge, shooting Wu Ying semi-pitying and semi-disgusted looks. With a grimace, Wu Ying scurried away, his face burning with shame at having the pair overhear his dressing down. Still, at least he had not been barred. He only needed to do better. He would do better, Wu Ying vowed, as he hurried away to wash off his shame and sweat. Chapter 4.
Thanks for showing me around, Wu Ying said as the pair walked along the stone paths. This morning, Wu Ying and Tao He were headed to the training grounds reserved for inner sect members. In particular, the second largest training grounds, the one unofficially reserved for the martial specialists.
And sorry again for leaving you.
No need for the apology, Tao He said. I was forced to complete a lot of paperwork anyway. But I'm surprised you're interested in martial specialization.
Why? Wu Ying said with a frown. It seems like a good fit with my family training.
Oh, you have the training,
Tao He said, nodding.
But you're not like... Well, you'll see.
Not useful.
When Tao refused to elaborate on his cryptic statement, Wu Ying added, "How about you? How did you end up with the martial specialists?"
"My sponsor sent them to find me,"
Tao said with a roll of his eyes.
"Seems like he felt I would fit in."
"And do you?"
"It's been fun sparring."
Wu Ying shook his head at his friend's statement. "Are you going to take this as your supporting occupation?" Tao shook his head.
"Too much trouble. I was thinking of specializing in tea ceremonies."
Wu Ying stumbled, turning to stare at Tao. Wu Ying's jaw worked, words failing to come before he sighed and slapped his friend on the back.
"Then I'll expect to be invited to more tea parties." "We'll have to find a third then,"
Tao said. Wu Ying spotted a quartet of nobles, each of them clad as gaudily as they could manage in sect robes, sauntering along the paths. In particular, Wu Ying's gaze flicked to a noble's jian, sheathed at his side. Bedecked in jewels and gold on both sheath and hilt, the weapon looked useless in combat to Wu Ying's experienced eyes. His lips curled at the sight. "What are you looking at?" the noble in question snarled. "Nothing," Wu Ying said reflexively, before remembering and straightening himself. He was no longer a peasant or an outer sect member. While they might have a higher status, it was only by degrees. "Nothing at all." "Are you calling me a liar?" The noble stepped closer before his friend blocked him with his fan. The jian-wielding noble's gaze flicked to Tao He, and recognition appeared in his eyes before he inclined his head to his friend and erstwhile leader. "You pair are the new body cleansers from the latest intake, yes?" the leader of the opposing cultivators said.
"Yes, senior,"
Tao He replied. "Leave them," the leader said. "There's nothing to be gained from dealing with body cleansers." The bejeweled jian user sneered at his friend's words, but still, the group walked off. Wu Ying compressed his lips, his hand clenching and releasing by his side before he shook his head. The damn nobles thought they were so much better. "Let's go, Tao," Wu Ying said. His friend smiled wryly and led the way, bringing Wu Ying to the training grounds without further incident. When Wu Ying arrived, he found his attention taken by the impressive view. The training complex was made up of a trio of double-story buildings which ringed the grounds. Toward the northern portion of the grounds, the archery range abutted the slopes of the mountain. In the center of the training grounds, a series of raised combat stages were situated in the traditional hexagram pattern. Those farthest from the entrance glimmered in the morning sunlight as the chi barriers broke up the rays. The chi barriers were erected to mitigate attacks delivered from within. Closer to the entrance, the stages were bare of such extravagances, meant for those looking to practice mundane techniques or who could not project their chi as yet. Already, in the early morning, numerous bodies crowded the training floors. Some trained in the bare ground in the west, working a variety of wooden dummies, while others walked, skipped, jumped, and otherwise moved from painted footprint to painted footprint. In another portion of the floor, various kettlebells and iron jars were being used to build strength, a few of the more enthusiastic individuals being beaten upon by sticks while carrying those jars. Overall, the entirety of the training grounds was filled with muscular, enthusiastic, and focused individuals. While the majority of those were men, there were a significant number of women moving through the routines, most of them wielding weapons of one form or the other. "Brother Tao Hua!" a cheerful voice called from within the grounds as the pair made their way down. The speaker had the longest hair.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.